story in the Old Testament that's found here in 2 Kings chapter 5. And it's kind of a strange story given the circumstance and the situations of what's going on. And the storybook that she has this man that doesn't look pretty at all. He has, of course, it's cartoon drawings, but this man in this cartoon drawing has warts hanging out everywhere and stuff falling off of him, and he's greenish. And then on the next page, he's restored. And it's the story of Elisha and Naaman. Naaman the leper. And in this particular story, it's not so much about the healing of Naaman as it is the revelation that God demonstrates his grace to us. So if you would look with me at 2 Kings chapter 5, and I'm excited to share this story with you. And I'm going to read the entire thing here in a moment, but I want to highlight here verse 8 through verse 14. If you would stand with me as we read the word of God together. 2 Kings chapter 5, I'll begin reading here in verse 8 to verse 14. But when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent to the king saying, "Why have you torn your clothes? Let him come now to me that he may know that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and stood at the door of Elisha's house. And Elisha sent a messenger to him saying, "Go and wash yourself in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored and you shall be clean." But Naaman was angry and went away saying, "Behold, I thought that he would surely come out to me, stand, call upon the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the place and cure a leper. Are not Abner and Parphar, the rivers of Damascus, better than the waters of Israel? Could not I wash in them and be cleaned?" So he turned and went away in rage. But his servants came near and said to him, "My father, it is a great word the prophet has spoken to you. Will you not do it? Has he actually said to you, 'Wash and be clean'?" So he went down, dipped himself 7 times in the Jordan. Notice this, according to the word of the man of God. And his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. Let us pray. Great God and Savior, we acknowledge that you are truly good to us and that you are indeed a gracious and loving God. So in this moment, we recognize that your grace has been provided to us once again as we hear the reading of your word. And now we ask that your grace be multiplied to us as we unpack this text together to discover what you are intending for us to know, but not just to know, but to actually live out. And so we're asking now that you would awaken our hearts and our minds that we may understand the truth of this text. Allow me to die so that Christ may live through me, so that we may all live together in him. And we ask this in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Now, 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Kings, obviously it's the Old Testament, and there's a lot of things that have happened throughout 1 and 2 Kings that we need to just quickly summarize together. So at the very beginning of 1 and 2 Kings, you have this circumstance that's going on, particularly 1 Kings, where you have King David, who has passed away. You have King Solomon, who's come about. And then in the latter part, probably, I believe it's around chapters 11 and chapters 12, Solomon passes away, and there's some pretty bad kings that come on the scene in the land of Israel, Rehoboam and Jeroboam. And those two men end up dividing the kingdom of Israel. The once united kingdom under the monarchy of David and Solomon has now been divided. And obviously a divided kingdom cannot stand. That's kind of a reference that Jesus makes in his gospel ministry. And so you have this divided kingdom, but God, by his grace, sends prophets to preach the message of God's reign to the people. And it's a message, a very simple message, and it's the message that all the prophets preach, and it's a message that all of the gospel messengers in the New Testament preach. It's a very simple message, and it's clear: repent. Turn back and place your faith back in Yahweh. Trust in Him and He will provide for you. And so there are two specific prophets that God raises up. Is something happening? Okay. God raises up two specific prophets in 1 and 2 Kings. The first prophet is Elijah. Elijah, we know of Elijah. He called down fire from the heavens, and it's just a miraculous event, actually. Can you just imagine standing there as the fire is falling down from the heavens? And then you know of Elijah as well as he hears the still small voice. And then at the very beginning of 2 Kings, you have another man come on the scene, a man who receives a double portion of Elijah's prophecy, this double portion of Elijah's miracles, a double portion of Elijah's message. His name is Elisha. And Elisha, this young prophet, in 2 Kings chapter 4 through chapter 6, you have all these miracles that Elisha is performing. And all these miracles from 4 through 6 point to chapter 5, actually. The center part of God's dealings with Israel, the center part of God's dealings with the world is found in the miracle of the healing of Naaman. Now look with me beginning here in verse 1 of chapter 5. And let me show you the irony of this. Naaman, commander of the army of the king of where? Syria? Seriously? Not Israel. So Naaman here is not the commander of the armies of the king of Israel. Naaman here is a pagan. Naaman here is not part of the people of God. He is an enemy of the people of God. By the way, we'll see here in a moment that Naaman actually goes into Israel, ransacks the people of God, and brings back a little slave for himself. So Naaman here is not a very nice person. He's the commander of the army of Syria. But notice this. The text says he was a great man. He was a great man. Not only that, he was in high favor because the Lord had given him victory. The Lord not only used the people of Israel to bring about His kingdom, but God also used pagan nations for His glory. That's the point here. And not only this, notice this. He was a mighty man of valor. This phrase is only used a few times in the Old Testament. One, it's applied to Gideon. Gideon is a man of valor. Boaz was a man of valor. And now it says that Naaman, this pagan, who was the commander of the armies of Syria. He is a man of valor. But he had a problem, didn't he? He was a leper. Ooh, that's a change in the text, isn't it? So this man is powerful. This man was a mighty military man. This man had prominence. This man had popularity. But this man also had a problem. And the problem was himself. He was the issue. It wasn't the fact that his army was losing. It wasn't the fact that he lost his popularity or power. It was the fact that he himself was the problem. And so we see this story being set up here. And what we're going to see develop is this one specific point. But notice here in verse 2. And the Syrians won. On one of the raids, carried off a little girl from the land of Israel who worked in the service of Naaman's wife. And she said to the mistress, "Would that my lord were with the prophet who is in Samaria. He would cure him of his leprosy. So Naaman went in and told his lord, "Thus and so spoke the girl from the land of Israel." And the king of Syria said, "Go now, and I will send a letter to the king of Israel." And so this little girl who's a slave to Naaman speaks the message of good news to him, saying, "Hey, Naaman, you have an issue, but there's a man in Israel who can cure you. There's a man who can remedy your problem, a man who can speak on your behalf to Yahweh himself, and you can be healed." And so Naaman, of course, "Well, I want to go do this. I want to go." Now, you would think, actually, Naaman has two choices here. He can either say, well, I'm too proud and I'm not going to do that. I'm the leading commander here in the army of Syria. I'm this man of prominence, this man of valor. I'm not going to Israel. But you see this humility that comes out in Naaman. And if we miss it in the text, we miss what God is teaching us through that. That Naaman here, even though he is prominent, even though he has power, even though he has popularity, recognizes that he has a problem and he can't fix his problem. But this little girl, notice the irony in this fact that he was a mighty man, but he hears the message of a little girl from Israel. And she says there's a prophet who can cure him. So here in the latter part of verse 5, so he went taking him 10 talents of silver. A talent roughly weighed about 75 pounds. So he's bringing him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 changes of clothes. So we're really not sure how much this is, the equivalent nowadays, but it's a lot. It's a lot of stuff that he's bringing. And so you have to remember that this one important fact, Naaman's not going by himself. We'll see in a moment that he brings his entire entourage with them. All these horses and chariots are coming. He brought the letter to the king of Israel, which read, when this letter reaches you, know that I have sent to you Naaman, my servant, that you may cure him of his leprosy. And when the king of Israel read this, he tore his clothes and said, am I God to kill and make alive, that this man sends word to me to cure a man of leprosy? Only consider and see how he's seeking to quarrel with me. Here's the issue. The king of Israel receives this letter from a man who just ransacked his entire country. And now this man who ransacked his entire country is sending his commanding officer to go down to Israel, which he just ransacked, in order to be cured. You can imagine the ethical dilemma that this king is facing right now. What in the world am I going to do? And he says, I think he's coming to quarrel with me, to fight with me. That this man has the gall to simply stand here and bargain with me, send his commanding officer. I'm not God. Notice the intensity of the language, to kill or to make alive. That this leprosy was so bad for Naaman that it was to the point where the king recognizes this. You can just imagine Naaman standing in front of the king and seeing this old decrepit guy as skin's falling off, and it's just a nasty thing. Do I have the power to make this man alive? This man who just ransacked my village, this man who just ransacked Jerusalem, is coming and he's asking me to help him. Verse 8, but when Elisha, and notice the title of Elisha, it doesn't say the prophet, it says what? The man of God. What a title that is. Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes. By the way, tearing of the clothes just means outrage. He's ripping his clothes, just an utter outrage. He sent to the king saying, why have you torn your clothes? Let him come to me that he may, here's the purpose, not so that he may be healed, so that what? He may know that there's a prophet in Israel, meaning that there's a prophet who speaks on behalf of the one true God. Anytime you see this phrase in the Old Testament, it's really not about the prophet himself. It's about God. The prophet's speaking about Yahweh. So Naaman came, notice this, with his horses and chariots and stood at the door of Elisha's house. Now, Elisha, a prophet, he doesn't draw income. It's not like he goes out and he's not a traveling evangelist where he's getting a paycheck every week. No. So Elisha's house is probably this little bitty hut. Not a very impressive structure at all. And so you can just see this image here, Naaman with all the horses, all the chariots, his whole entourage and posse, and all these bags of money standing before this itty bitty hut with Elisha inside. Now notice this. And Elisha, verse 10, sent a messenger He sent a messenger to him saying, go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, Jordan River, and your flesh shall be restored and you shall be clean. Are you serious, Elisha? Wait. Time out, Elisha. This leader, this commander, this man of prominence, this man of valor, this man who has power and might, this man with his entire posse, entire entourage, is standing before you, and you don't even go out and talk to him, but you send your little pipsqueak out to talk to him. This is showing us something about the way God works. And he really doesn't care about your prominence. He doesn't care about your popularity. He doesn't care about your power. He cares about your issue. He cares about your problem. But he handles all of us the same way. It doesn't matter about the peripheral things. You can't bargain with God. Well, God, I've done this, I've done this, I've done this. You've helped me in the past. But notice verse 11. And Naaman, of course, was angry. It's the understatement of the year. He was angry and went, saying, behold, I thought, now you can just hear the sarcasm and frustration in this. I thought that he would surely come out to meet me, stand and call upon the name of the Lord his God, and wave his hand over the place and cure the leper. You would think that's what a prophet is supposed to do, right? That's what a good prophet is supposed to do. To go out there and to meet the needs of the people. But instead, he sends his little messenger out there to go say, what? Go dip in the Jordan River 7 times. Not 6, not 5, not 4, not 3, not 2, not 1. 7. Number of completion. So you can just imagine the frustration. Here are the sarcasm in this, verse 12. Abner and Parfar, are not these rivers in Damascus where Syria is? Are not these rivers better than all the rivers in Israel? So he's having a good competition here. Israel's not very good. We just ransacked everything of their land. And now he wants me to dip myself in the Jordan 7 times. I could have done that back home. I could have used my own shower. Could I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in rage. But notice here, verse 13, but his servants came near and said, His servants begin to speak this message. My father, this is a great word that the prophet has spoken to you. Will you not do it? Go wash in the river 7 times. Why? Because did he actually say, wash and be clean? Isn't that what Elisha said? Go dip yourself in the river 7 times and you will be clean? So Naaman has a choice here, doesn't he? He can obey the word. We could disobey the word. This word that comes from the prophet, which is ultimately coming from God. It's really not about Elisha. The main character of this story is not about Elisha, it's God. He has a choice. Naaman has a choice. Will he obey God's word or will he disobey God's word? What does he do? So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times. And notice here, according to the word of the man of God. Which basically means according to God's word. God said this, dip yourself in the river. And he said, okay, I have no other option. My skin's falling off. I'm decrepit. I'm nasty. I got to do this. So what does he do? According to the word of the man of God, he does. Notice this, and his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child. You can just look at little kids, and they have nice skin, don't they? Like a little child. But get this. The mighty man listened to a little girl, and he obeyed the little girl's message, and he listened to his servants, and then his flesh is restored like a little child. The point that I want to bring to you is very simple. God graciously transforms our lives when we obey his word. God graciously transforms our lives. You have to remember that Naaman is a pagan. He's a heathen. He just ransacked the people of God, but God extended him grace. And he transformed this man's life when he obeyed God at his word. Jesus talks about this at the very end of the Sermon on the Mount, where he gives this illustration, this parable of two men, the foolish builder and the wise builder. And he says that you have these two men, and there's this big storm that's a-coming. And if you've watched the news lately, there was a monster typhoon that just ransacked Taiwan. We have some missionary friends over there. And just imagine this big storm is coming, Jesus is telling this illustration. And you have these two men. One is a foolish man, one is a wise man. And the foolish man decided that he was going to go and he was going to build his house upon the sand. And when the typhoon ran through, what happened? The house collapsed. It was gone. But he says there's also a wise man who built his house upon the rock. And when the rains came and the winds blew, his house didn't fall. And the illustration is not so much about building your house upon the rock or upon the sand as it is hearing the word of God and doing the word of God. That's Jesus' point. That if you obey God at his word, the things of life won't crush you. If you obey him, God will radically transform your life by his grace. But if you don't obey his word, your life won't be transformed. His grace will not come to you. And this pagan man, this man who had prominence, this man who had power, this man who had prestige, this man also had a problem, and his problem was fixed because he took God at his word. He obeyed him. He heard the word, and he obeyed the word. And notice this, verse 15. And then he returned to the man of God and all his company, and he came and stood before him. And he's going to do three things here. We'll run through this just very quickly. I want to show you this because it highlights something about God's grace. So God transforms our lives when we obey God at his word. Notice this. And behold, I know that there is no God in all the earth but in Israel. There's only one God. Let me just remind you. I think you know, but let me remind you one more time. There's only one God. There's only one God who can transform lives. We erect idols. John Calvin said that our hearts are a factory, an idol factory, perpetually producing these idols. So we erect gods in our lives and idols in our lives, but nothing can save us and nothing can transform us except the God who dwells where? In Israel. So accept now a present from your servant. So Naaman here, you remember all the stuff that Naaman had in the back of his pickup? So he brings all this stuff out and lays it before Elisha and says, you healed me, therefore take my money. It's a barter, exchange, a transaction, right? So what does Naaman say? He said to him, as the Lord lives before whom I stand, I will receive none. Have you ever had that person you offer them money? No, I'm not going to take it. I'm not going to take it. And finally, you're just so frustrated. Take the money! You can just imagine the situation here. Naaman, take the money, Elisha. No, I'm not going to take your money. Take the money. I'm not going to take your money. And then finally, Elisha throws down the trump card, which says, as God lives before whom I stand, I'm not going to receive any of your money. Whew. And he urged him to take it, but he refused. The point is, it's very clear, I think, that you can't barter with God. God's grace is free. It's the gift of God. You can't pay off God. You can't barter with God. You can't look and say, well, God, I've done all these great and wonderful things for you. I'm a man of prominence. I'm a man of valor. I'm just this wonderful person, even though I have a problem. Oh, forget the problem. Look at all this stuff that I've done for you. Look at all this money in the back of my car. Look at this, God, and you lay it before him, and God says, I'm not going to receive any of your money. All that is worthless. You can't pay off God. God transforms people not by how much they have, and honestly, not by how much they do for him, but simply out of his free and loving grace. Notice this. Then Naaman said, if not, please let there be given to your servant 2 mule loads of earth, For from now on, your servant will not offer burnt offerings or sacrifice to any other god but the Lord. You may be thinking, so he has all this money in the back of his truck. Now he's going to fill his truck full of dirt? Yeah, why? Because God's grace is so free that God's grace changed this man's life and empowered him to worship God. He's going to take this dirt back and build an altar to the Lord. So God's grace is free, but God's grace also radically alters people's lives and empowers them to worship God. In his verse 18, now in this matter, may the Lord pardon your servant. When my master goes into the house of Rimmon and worship there, leaning on my arm and bow myself in the house of Rimmon. And when I bow myself in the house of Rimmon, the Lord pardon your servant in this matter. Well, that's kind of strange. Let me explain this. So he just said, I'm going to go take this dirt, and I'm going to go and I'm going to build an altar. I'm not going to worship any other god except for the God who dwells in Israel. But by the way, may God have mercy on me when I go and I take my master into this foreign god's house and he worships there. Kind of a contradictory statement, isn't it? I'm going to worship God, but yet I'm going to go into this other god's house. Well, the issue is, he's the commander-in-chief of the army, and one of his duties as the commander-in-chief has to take the king of Syria to worship this foreign god, God Rimmon, which is the storm god. So he has to go. One of his duties is to go and to lead this man in worship. But he says, may God pardon me. May the Lord forgive me when I do this. The point is, even when you sin, God's grace covers it. God's grace is so free. God's grace is so good that when you obey God at his word and take him at his word, he transforms your broken life. And not only just transforms you once, but he continually transforms you so that you can worship God freely. That even when you sin, God forgives you. I don't know about you, but that's good news for a rebel like me. That God is a forgiving and loving God. He knows that he has to do this because his duty requires him to do it. But he knows, may God forgive me. My heart is not in worshiping this foreign deity. My heart wants to worship the Lord. And when I do sin, may he forgive me. What does Elisha say? And he said to him, go in peace. Isn't that exactly what Jesus says? Go, sin no more. Remember the woman who was caught in the act of adultery? Remember the story in John? And this woman who's standing, who is, by the way, just naked, stripped of her clothes, standing before Messiah. And all these men gathered around and wanted to kill her. Jesus says, he who's without sin, take the first stone. Go ahead, chunk it. I dare you. At the very end of the story, you know what Jesus says? Go and sin no more. He recognized the problem, corrected the problem, and corrected everybody else's problem as well, or highlighted everybody else's problem. But he says, don't go back to your old way of life. Change. God gave her that power, and God gives us that same ability by his grace. But notice here, the story doesn't stop there. So we have two points that we've developed so far. First, God transforms our lives when we obey his word. I think we know that. And God, by his benevolent and sovereign love and grace, is completely and utterly free, that he gives his grace freely. But again, the story doesn't stop here. But when Naaman, very end of verse 19, but when Naaman had gone from him a short distance, so he packs up his car, he packs up everything, and they're going back to Syria. Gehazi, verse 20, notice his description, the servant of Elisha, the man of God. So he has a pretty stout position. He's the associate pastor here. The servant of Elisha, the man of God, this is Gehazi, said, "See, my master has spared this Naaman, the Syrian, in not accepting from his hand what he has brought. As the Lord lives, I will run after him and get something from him." So you have Gehazi just sitting there watching everything that has transpired in the life of this pagan Naaman. He has seen God's grace come up in his life, transformed his life. The leper that was one, the man who was once a leper is now cleansed. He sees his master, Elisha, say, "I'm not going to take your money." And so what does Gehazi think? Elisha didn't get any money, but I'm on the payroll as well. Maybe I can get something. So what does he do? He goes and he runs after him. So Gehazi followed Naaman. And when Naaman saw someone running after him, he got down from his chariot to meet him and said, "Is all well?" And Gehazi said, "All is well. My master has sent me to say, now there's just now come from the hill country of Ephraim two young men of the sons of the prophets. Give them a talent of silver and a change of clothes." Two changes of clothes. What does Gehazi do? He lied. He didn't bend the truth. It's not a white lie. He flat out lied. And Naaman said, "Be pleased to take two talents." And he urged him and tied two talents of silver in two bags and two changes of clothes and laid them on two of his servants. And they carried them before Gehazi. And when he had came to the hill, he took them from their hand. He didn't even go back to the house with these things. He puts them on himself. He put them in the house. And he sent the men away and they departed. The story would be boring if it stopped there. And you know, if you've read scripture enough, that something is about to take place. So what takes place? And he went in and stood before his master. And Elisha said to him, "Where have you been, Gehazi?" Is this reminiscent of any other Adam? Where are you? Peter looking at Ananias and Sapphira, did you do this? And he said, "Your servant went nowhere." Come on, man. Gehazi, are you serious? You know that he speaks on behalf of God. You know that he is a prophet of God. And you've lied twice. Come on, man. And he said to him, this is Elisha saying to Gehazi, "Did not my heart go when the men turned from his chariot to meet you?" The point is, he knew the entire time. Was it a time to accept money or garments, olive orchards, vineyards, sheep, oxen, male servants, and female servants? The point is, I knew that you were going to do this. And when you did it, it was, caught you red-handed. Gehazi, the servant of the man of God. By the way, Gehazi is an Israelite. He should have known better. He knows the law of God. He runs around with Elisha, who is the prophet of God, the primary prophet of God here. He should have known that if he lies to the prophet of God, who is he lying to? Lies directly to his face. This is similar to a story that we just read in the book of Acts. Verse 27. Therefore, the leprosy of Naaman the pagan, Naaman the non-Israelite, Naaman the man who just ransacked your house, Gehazi, shall cling to you and your descendants forever. And he went out from his presence a leper, like snow. God's grace is free. But when you presume on God's grace, it will cost you something. When you flat out defy God and his word, there will be consequences and there will be correction. God is a benevolent and loving and merciful and slow to anger type God. His grace is abundantly free. His grace is freely given and his grace will transform your life. But when you defy a holy and righteous God in such a way like Gehazi did, there will be correction in your life. God disciplines those whom he loves. Gehazi still remained some sort of assistant. Gehazi didn't flat out rebel against God and then everything was taken away from him. No, he still remained an Israelite. He still remained part of the people of God. But you see this difference here in the text. Naaman, a pagan, obeyed Yahweh. But you see Gehazi, who was an associate pastor on the payroll, rebelling against God. The text demonstrates for us two elements of God's grace. An element that transforms our lives in the person of Naaman, which we've seen. But we've also seen God's corrective grace as well. God's grace that cost Gehazi something. God's transforming grace is absolutely free, but when you presume on God's grace, it costs you something. In the life of Gehazi, the prophet, this assistant to the prophet, the leprosy that was on Naaman came onto him. That's a pretty bad consequence. That's a pretty stout correction if you understand what's going on in the text. But it's a pretty stout correction for God to strike down Ananias and Sapphira as well when they flat out lied against God. When they knew that they shouldn't do it, and when they were acting selfishly to promote themselves and make themselves proud, gone. They were part of the people of God as well. Gehazi was part of the people of God. His grace is not a license to sin, but his grace grants us the liberty to obey him freely. That's something that Gehazi didn't understand. He misunderstood God. He misunderstood God's grace. It wasn't a license to go out and do whatever you want, but his grace empowers you to live in a way where you can't obey him. Paul brings this up at the very beginning of Romans chapter 6. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Does grace allow you to live however you want? Does God's grace allow you just to do what you please, just because you think God's going to just simply look over you, look over your sin? It transforms your life. God, by his grace, will transform your life when you obey him. But you disobey him, there will be consequences. When I was younger, I would spend summers, as we go into a time of invitation, I'd spend summers with my grandparents up in Kansas. And every night we would play games together. And I really don't like playing board games, but they love playing board games, so I play board games with them. And so we play Chinese checkers. I was pretty good at Chinese checkers, so I like playing that game. The game of life, I couldn't stand that game because I didn't have a big enough car. I didn't make enough money. I didn't go to college. So I really didn't like that game. But one game I really didn't like, just because it lasted forever, was Monopoly. Didn't have enough money. I always landed on the spots where I had to pay money, more money. But then I'd have to go to jail. But there was always that time when I'd flip over that card and I'd get a get-out-of-jail-free card. Now everything's fine, right? The fact of the matter is, a lot of us think that God's grace is simply a get-out-of-jail-free card. God's grace is not a get-out-of-jail-free card. God's grace is a get-out-of-jail-free card and live-your-life-differently type card. where you don't return back to your old way of life like Gehazi did. God's grace will transform you when you obey his word. But when you don't obey his word and you defy God, his grace will come and correct you. God corrected Gehazi because he loved him. Will you rely on God's grace to transform you this morning? If there's an area in your life where you're presuming on God's grace and you simply think that he's going to grant you a get-out-of-jail-free card, repent. Plead with God to forgive you. His grace does cover your sin, but his grace also comes at a cost. It comes at a cost where you need to acknowledge the sin in your own heart and life, the sin in my own heart, in my own life. He will transform us because his grace is free. Mercy there, grace was free, multiplied to me. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. This story points us to Jesus, a free and loving Savior who gives of his grace to rebels like us and continues to transform us into not our image, but into his image. Will you rely on his grace this morning to transform you? But will you also repent in the areas of your life where you need to repent? Lean on his grace. Press into it that he may change you. Father, we come to you and we ask that you would change us this morning. Transform us by your grace. May we understand the truth of this text and may we rely on your grace. May we press into it. But God, keep us from presuming on your grace. May we repent of our sins so that your corrective grace won't abound to us, but your loving grace will. I pray this now, believing, God, that you're working in our hearts and our minds. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.